Okay.
Today is May 20th, 1998. The survivor is Eugene Rajsky. The last name at birth is Reisman. The interviewer is Bonnie Slavin, the city Kissimmee, the state Florida, the country the United States of America. The language is English. This is tape one. Today is May 20th, 1998. My name is Bonnie Slavin, S-L-A-V-I-N. Today I'm pleased to be conducting an interview with Mr. Eugene Rajsky of Kissimmee, Florida, the United States of America. What is your name?
Eugene Rajsky.
Spell it, please.
R-A-J-S-K-Y.
What was your name at birth?
Reisman.
Spell it.
R-E-I-S-M-A-N.
What was your first name at birth?
In Hungarian, it was Jenő. Official registered in the birth certificate and papers.
How do you spell it?
J E N O. It's in Hungarian Jenő.
Did you have any other names? Nicknames, Hebrew names?
Hebrew, yes. Yaakov Shemuel.
Where were you born?
In Vrbove, a town in the old Austria-Hungarian monarchy. It belonged at the time to Hungary.
How do you spell that?
V-R-B-O-V-E.
And when were you born?
October the 5th, 1913.
How old are you now?
84.
Mr. Rajsky, what was the name of your mother's parents?
Mother's parents were Donat. Moritz Donat, the grandfather, and Amelia Donat, born Weiss Donat.
Where were they from?
They were from a village in Slovakia by the name of Podolie. P-O-D-O-L-I-E.
Do you remember them?
Yes.
Would you describe them?
Oh, my grandfather was, when I was 5 years old, I remember him, that he was slender built and sick. I don't know the reason of his death in 1919. At that time, it was unclear. He was 70, I was told.
What kind of person was he?
A very kind person. He had I look for the word, a store and a liquor store, like a like like a restaurant. Most serving liquor to the population and in the store, of course. And he was very popular under the situation, being a Jew and being surrounded by only Catholics who were fed, always with the stories that the Jews killed their own son, our son.
Did you hear those stories?
No, because this is when they ended their business before First World War, when the grandfather died. That was after. And my grandmother lived alone the first few years in the same village where we lived, my parents, Prvove. She sold their property, what they had, and moved to our town. And later on, when she was getting older, she lived with us, my family.
Do you have any special memories about her?
Yes. I remember her. I have some photographs. As I remember her, she was just old. I was a kid, and she was suffering from arthritis, as I remember. She was at a, was not a time like today that we have medications.
What languages did she speak when she spoke to you? What did she speak?
Oh, to me, she spoke Slovak and German. And she spoke Hungarian, too.
What was your mother's first name?
Sidonia. Sidonia.
What do you remember about your mother?
Oh, she was a hard-working housewife of a farmer's wife. She has to, in the later years, she had help. When I was born during the war, before the war a year, but then during the war.
Which war was that?
First World War. So she had some help because she had to supervise the going and coming of workers from the field. And as a housewife.
Did you have any special times with her? Do you remember anything special that you did with her?
To tell the truth, she didn't have her time. She went up at 6 o'clock in the morning, 5:30, and the fresh milk from the cows were brought in, and people were coming to buy the fresh milk. And she had to run here and there for the one or two servants, because my father was at that time about 7 in the school. And that was number one. And the rest was on her. I remember being very busy. All the time, she didn't have too much time to. Of course, she helped me sometimes because she was quite a little bit educated for that time. She helped me with my homework from school.
How high an education did she have? How far did she go up?
As far as I remember, she had six or seven grades. And then she had some business school in Vienna, Austria, where she had uncles and near relatives who lived there.
Was she interested in music? Did she enjoy reading?
She didn't have had too much time. She was so busy during the day. She read the newspapers, of course, and she read some books, but I don't remember precisely.
Was she a good cook?
Oh, yes. All Jewish mothers were good cooks. Oh, yeah.
What were some of your her favorite dishes that you enjoyed?
All of them.
Name one.
There were no steaks because it was a kosher household. It could have been steaks too, but I really cannot tell because all of them were tasty. Twice a week it was no meat day on Wednesday and Friday at noon, but on Friday it was Shabbos, and there was a meal. Oh, turkeys, goose, and other.
Do you remember your father's parents?
Father's parents, as I remembered before, my grandfather, but he died in 18 or 19. And I remember him vaguely. Maybe it's because I was told. But I remember him when I went with him in his coffee. At noon, afternoon, he took me by the hand and went through the town to a Jewish-owned coffee house where he met with his friends.
What was his name?
Max Reisman. They called him Motche.
And what kind of work did he do?
He was he sold glass for pictures, and he made frames and for pictures, orders people came for this.
And your grandmother? What was her name?
My grandmother. No. My brain. My grandmother. I mentioned it, I guess, when we talked before, and it slipped my mind now.
Okay, we'll come back to that. Can you describe your grandmother? What was she like?
Well, yes, she, because we left my mother during the war in, that was a double house. One part was where we lived. And I was her only grandchild in town. She had grandchildren in other towns, but I was her preferred.
How did you know you were the preferred one?
Because she told me.
Did she give you special presents or treats?
Treats. Present, there was not too much money. She delivered 15 children, from which 5 died. But to have 10 children 1 year after another, she was quite a busy lady. And, it was a conflict of love between my mother and the grandmother.
It was.
Yeah. All of them wanted to feed me. More than I could eat. No, it's a little bit emotional. I didn't think that I am able to be emotional anymore. Well?
What was your father's name?
Joseph.
What was he like?
A good man. Hard working in the fields when he started, and then when he employed people, he was rough on himself and rough on every employees. He requested the same work delivered as he was used to, because he started from nothing. He got a dowry from my mother's marriage, and so they started to build and to buy property and to work on it.
Do you know what kind of a dowry he was given?
Dowry? A lot of money at the time. As I remember, it was 15,000 golden. It's very difficult to express what you could have bought for 15,000. You could have bought 3 big houses. It's equivalent maybe to $200,000.
What kinds of things did your father grow?
I would need a vocabulary for that. This sugar cane. And how do I? Oh boy, my.
Did he grow different vegetables?
Not vegetables. We have a vegetable garden, and there were different vegetables, and including potatoes, fresh when the season came.
Did you ever help him in the
fields?
Yes.
Oh yes.
What
oh.
kinds of things did you do?
Digging, and during the summertime, and there was the crop, hoarding them on the back to the wagon, and bringing them up to our house. Storing them. And then I, usually when I could, as a mashgiach, I was present when the cows were milked, because we were strict kosher. I say conservative. That would be.
Do you have any brothers or sisters?
I had a sister who perished in Auschwitz.
What was her name?
Serene. S-E-R-E-N.
What was her last name at that time? Do you remember?
When she died, after being 3 years married, I don't know.
How do you know she died at Auschwitz?
Because witnesses, from my cousin. From the other side of the family, survived and told me that she was alive when the Germans took them before the advancing Soviet Russian army.
What year was
army.
That? But that she was taken.
She was killed when she left the marching bands of women. She fled to a house nearby, and this witness has seen that SS or other murderer went after her, and they heard a shot, and since then she perished. Nobody saw her anymore. And 3 days later they were liberated by it.
Where had she been before that?
Auschwitz.
So, was this when they evacuated Auschwitz?
Yes.
Do you have any other brothers or sisters?
I have a brother. He lives in Bratislava, Slovakia now.
What is his name?
He changed his name to Milan. He lived during the war on false papers. When they took our parents, he was hidden by not Jews for money. And He worked on the farm as a laborer.
In what country?
In Slovakia, with false papers which he got from a friend of his.
What's his first name?
Milan, M-I-L-A-N, but his first name, born as Manfred. Should I spell it?
What kind of schooling did you have?
I have basic school, middle school till altogether 9 years, and 2 years of business.
Were these public schools?
These were Jewish. The 5 years were Jewish school and 4 years were public school.
Where were the schools?
In my hometown, Vrbove.
Did you go to school and come home every day for lunch?
Yes, yes. We didn't have had any other. For lunch and twice, three times a week. It was school for 2 hours, and once it was early afternoon, was Hebrew instructors, Melamed. We learned Hebrew reading, writing, history. 3 times a week, besides that.
What was the name of the school, the Jewish school?
Jewish school.
Did you have to wear a uniform?
No. No. The school was financed as all Catholic and Evangelic Protestant were paid partly by the government. And supporting it, over 50% were the churches or the Jewish community. But the teachers were paid by the federal, by the government.
What were your favorite subjects?
History. History and geography.
What did you want to be when you grew up?
I wanted to be a lawyer. But my father was against it, that I will grow up as a goy. My mother wanted me to, but father was the boss, so I graduated private school and went as a sales clerk and in a small department store to take care of the paperwork.
Mr. Rajsky, we're going to stop the camera so we can change the tape. Today is, the survivor is Mr. Eugene Rajsky. This is tape two. Could you describe what your Jewish community was like?
Well, most, quite 95% of 840 Jews were conservative. Some little more, some little less, but Orthodox, it was the name at the time. So, of course, the businesses were closed on Shabbos and holidays, everything. The village or the town was half dead because the businesses, textile, and shoe repair, and all kinds of business activity. Everybody was at home or in the synagogue.
What Jewish traditions did you observe in your home?
Well, first of all, kosher. Meat extra, milk product extra, very, very, very sensitive about that, and they were Friday evenings together. Prayer and afterwards good food.
Was there a lot of singing?
On normal Shabbat occasion were no special singing. Brachot, bruches, about wine, about bread. That was it. Of course, then Pesach was a different story, and Rosh Hashanah was a different story.
What was your favorite holiday?
I have to think. Until I was 16, all holidays were good and nice and a special Pesach because it had connection with Matzot and connection with the Jewish tradition, not only Sukkot or Purim too. But that was Pesach.
Do you remember your bar mitzvah?
Oh, yes. They were about in a room or a house they were about 25, 30 women with my mother. And the two rooms were reserved, a big table. There was a smaller table too. A table full of goodies and drinks. I remember when everybody left, I went from one leftover glass to another in different wine and slivovitz and drunk and got sick on my bar mitzvah. I remember that my two uncles were there too. I don't think I was ashamed.
Did you have a special suit for your bar mitzvah?
Yes. Blue, I think. Like this. Yeah, there were about 120 people there.
What was your daily life like when you were growing up?
Daily life. First of all, was school and soccer. Soccer twice and three times and five times. And when I came late evening at home, was a complaint from mainly my mother because I was not in time to the evening. Lunch was normally at 12 o'clock. From school, 12:30, 12:15. And dinner at 6 o'clock was dinner. And if somebody missed it, it was my mother didn't like it.
Did you play any other sports?
Yes, I played ping pong at that time. If billiards are a sport, then I played billiards too.
Where did you play billiards?
In a restaurant and a coffee house. Yeah. My father didn't like it because I played with goyim and different type. My father didn't like it when I played football because soccer because I would. He said I would play even with a gypsy. I said, at that time we were not racist or so different, but gypsies were gypsies. But I didn't play with gypsies, but with non-Jews too.
Did you ever bring any non-Jews home to your house?
That's a toughie. Not really.
Did you ever go to any person's home who was not Jewish?
Yes.
How were you greeted in that home?
Well, as a Jewish boy.
Which means?
Which means I was different. But we were friendly. But at that time, Catholics, they didn't tell me, the good friends of the family, and we bought there something. And the son was going to Jewish school, a friend of mine. But still, we were different, because we went. We had a different God, according to them, and we killed Yoisel, which is a made-up story, as we know.
Did you ever have any anti-Semitic incidents happen to you before, when you were growing up as a boy?
Yes. I had an altercation with a boy from my class. And later we just forgot it, and I was a popular football, soccer player later. But when I was 13, answering your question, we had some altercation. I don't know why. So I went at home, but our home was on the edge of the town. And behind the wall of a house, he went and hit me with a stone in my head. And ran away. There was no such thing at the time that the Jews bought for laborer's son do anything, or the police. So I ran home and went to the doctor's office, who was a Jew, and got the treatment. And then he apologized, and 5 years later he was happy when he could hold my suitcase, my soccer equipment, which I need. And he went after me, following me to the soccer place. It was not a stadium. Yeah.
Did your soccer team have a name to it?
Yeah, it was the sport club Bradlan, Bradlan. That was a name from the mountain 20 miles away. And Verboe.
Did you belong to any other clubs or organizations?
Yes, we started then. Before Bradlan, we had Maccabea. Most of us were Jews. I have a few pictures from that time. But we needed some extra strength and help, so we took in 2-3 non-Jews. And then I was, the bookkeeper and salesperson in another town. We created, with my help, Maccabi in that bigger town.
What was the name of that town?
Hlohovets, H-L-O-V-E-T-S.
Where was that near? I'm sorry, where was that near?
Yes. When I was... When I was... 19.
And what large city was that near?
Large city at the time was 10,000-12,000 people. That was
larger
large
than
city.
That. What was the next largest city?
The next largest city, a little bit larger, was Nitra. N-I-T-R-A. Now Nitra will have now 100,000. And then it was Trnava. T-R-N-A-V-A. That was the same size.
When you graduated business school, you then said you worked as an insurance sale, as a sales clerk.
Yes.
Where was that?
That was in that Hlohovets.
When was that, that you worked as a sales clerk? How old were you?
I was 18, 19.
And where did you live at that time?
In that town.
Did you live by yourself?
Yeah, I got a room. My employee, by the way, my employee was my... his wife was my cousin. So there I was about not quite 2 years.
And then where did you go?
Then I went home and helped my father in growing business. It was 1933 or 34. We started to hear some bad news from Germany, but we were so ignorant. When I was 16, I started to be a little bit a rebel, going back. I asked questions from the Gemara, from Tanakh, from Rashi. I asked questions about the commentaries about the different types of Jewish thinking and the commentaries. And I didn't get my answers. Finally, my father took me to the rabbi. And the rabbi told me, you don't ask questions, you are too young. When you will get older and you will have the Jewish education, you will find out for yourself. You have to believe it. I didn't. The first trefe salami I ate when I was 18, and I felt good because I was a rebel. He told me it's bad. I wanted to prove to myself it is true. So I, of course, my parents didn't know about that.
So you went back, and what kinds of things were you beginning to hear from Germany? And how did you find out the information?
The newspapers, radio, and later in about 36, 37, I remember a man came to us for a donation. A man, good looking, in his 50s, with a nice coat, I remember. sit down and he ate with us and told us that he fled. He left Germany for Czechoslovakia because for Jews there is no future. We didn't believe it. I started to, because I was Zionistic inclined and was then a member of Maccabi, and through that the Zionistic organization. That was in 36. And I wanted to go to Hakshara, if you know what I mean. Well, go to my parents' insistence that they need me at home. I didn't go. It was my mistake.
And then what happened? How did the climate change?
Slowly. First of all, the parents and the older people, middle-aged people, they didn't believe in the stories. The Czechoslovakia is strong enough. And I myself, I didn't think that the British and the French would tolerate Germans' expansion, not speaking about the Russians. But I was wrong. Many were wrong.
When did you begin to notice the changes around you from the Czechoslovakian people?
Slovak people. It's a big difference between the Czechs and Slovaks. Slovaks are all Catholics, 90%. The opposition, the 10% of Protestants, were sympathetic to us because a minority in a minority. When we felt anti-Semitism always. Because the Catholic Church was always indoctrinating their members, and that was the big majority. They believed that the Jews killed Christ, and that was the end of the discussion. Many times I tried to tell them that that's not their business because Yoisel Christ was a Jew, and that's our business. But it didn't help. When I started, when it started to be, now I was elected in 36 by a 30-member elected legislative body of the town, which my father was a member. I was elected as a comptroller because the Goyish comptroller embezzled money. So they thought, probably they thought, maybe this Jew will make some inroads and find out how much, and they were right. Now with my little background in accounting, so I started and I worked and was a member of the inner circle of the There were six members from the 30. Were six like commissioners, and one of them was my father. There was no nepotism at the time. I was elected because they needed somebody who knew accounting and...
How long did you serve?
Until they kicked me out in 39.
When did you notice a change of neighbors, of friends towards you? If you did.
They didn't have the guts to show it to me because I was a somebody. I was the controller at the time when the real anti-Semitism started. I wanted to emigrate. I asked my father. He said, me? I worked with your mother the whole 20 years and we invested and we worked. And somebody will take my house, my property? He was wrong. And so he was against that I should go to Israel, to Palestine. But I still worked in the organization and when it was too late in 39 when they kicked me out and I have had then to change places, my uncle's house and home, and sometimes in the other town.
Who kicked you out?
The leftovers of the legislature. I remember when I came out from the door, from the in the building, one man who knew my family and we knew each other. You are still here? Was the question. I remember it like it would happen yesterday. I said yes. But then I realized he's right. I have nothing to do here anymore. But they didn't want to let me go. Officially or not officially, the mayor and who was a friend of the family and younger than my father and respected my father. And, no, you don't have to go. I say no. That's it. You have nothing to do.
How large was your town? How many people live there?
5,000.
And what happened after 1939 when you stopped working for the government?
Well, I worked for a Jewish firm for 3 months and then they closed.
Doing what?
Bookkeeping.
And why did they close?
Because the Jewish businesses were slowly closing.
Mr. Rajsky, I'm going to stop the camera so we can change the tape. Then what happened in 1939 when you weren't working?
I applied to through the organization where I was active, in the Betar, and paid for, at that time it was a lot of money for the ship to go, to try to go to Palestine. That was in 39. It has taken a year, not a year, it was November, end of November, I was kicked, and 15th of May 1940, the ship moved on the Danube in Bratislava, moved toward our goal.
Before that, who did you contact other than that organization? Was there someone else that you had to contact to make the arrangements?
I had some distant relatives in Bratislava, and I went there and registered and brought the 10,000 crowns, which is like now it would be $20,000.
What did they tell you about the ship?
Nothing. Nothing. That was secret. It was always in secrecy. It had a Bulgarian flag and a Russian captain from the old Russian.
Do you remember his name?
I have it somewhere. I don't remember.
Where was the crew from?
The crew was some Romanians, Goyim, and the 2-3 Russians, I think. Russians who fled. Fled Russia.
Did you know who was going to be the passengers aboard that ship?
No. No, that was registered. And,
was it a legal ship?
Legal? Legal in certain, yes, it was legal, anchored in Bratislava and registered to Bulgaria with a Bulgarian flag. And according to papers, it was supposed we had some fake papers for Uruguay or Bolivia. It's a big difference between Bolivia and Uruguay, but one of the South American states. But we were not told that. That was a secret between top organization and only a few people knew.
Did they tell you the route they were going to take to Palestine? Did you know?
No, that was a ship rebuilt that had no balance. It was 50 years old. It has this wheels outside, which were moved by old machines, and In fact, we were stopped at Dobra in Yugoslavia because of that. We were there about 6 weeks. And before that, we were 4 weeks.
It was stopped because it was not...
It was not able to pass the restricted area in the Danube in Romania.
Did you travel with any friends? Did you know anybody that you were... Were you going with anyone?
Yeah, no. Well, yes. They were from a near town, bigger town, and Jewish bigger town, Pieszczany.
How many people were aboard, about?
513, 514.
Were there?
But altogether. Before that were only 300. But then we took another 100, because that means money. And money was involved, and one of the who recently died by the name of Schalk has stolen, or I don't know, it was stolen, it was not proven, it was not on the, it was not in court, but he took another 100, and we were like, precisely like sardines. I was laying down, but my legs were hanging outside. And here was my, it's only 60 centimeters room for a person. And that was supposed to be till Sulina, town on the Black Sea, Romania.
And where, excuse me, but where did they pick up the extra passengers? At what port?
Dobra, and Many in Dobra. They came another 120 from Germany, refugees. It's ex-richer people, and they were obnoxious to us because they were different. But anyway.
How many, what was the mix of men and women and children?
Well, most of us were young men from the Betar, from Slovakia, about 300. From that were maybe 30 girls, 40. And the rest were from Yugoslavia, from Hungary, and they were taken over. It was not planned because we have more and more were restricted, and the weight of the ship is overloaded, and we were under. The married couples were upstairs on the air, but we had only the possibility to leave twice a day for an hour. And that has to be organized because the ship has had to be balanced So on one side, 15, otherwise 15 went down in the underground, and then was rotated.
So to move around the ship, you had, they, it was organized?
Yeah, we organized it.
What was the food like?
The food was miserable, and we were in Dobra from the Yugoslav Jewish organization. We were supplied for before we left, because nobody thought we will be 3 months until we will move farther a little bit.
And what about sanitary conditions?
No, we're kept clean. We're, I have had the function to clean the lamps in the belly of the ship. They were petroleum lamps every day. That was my advantage, that I took them and went on the deck for free air, and so I had first-hand information about the movement, about the captain who was a drug addict and his wife. So.
So you started in Bratislava.
Yeah.
And then you went where?
Went the whole with these interruptions. Then the Yugoslavs, under the condition that we have the support of a real ship anchored 2 hours, that we don't drown in the middle of the waterway. So we went through, and we were, the end was Sulin, as I mentioned before. There, it was original planned that a normal ship, be it old, but a normal ship will, we will be transferred. But there was no money left. And so it was decided that we proceed with our old camp, which was only a tugboat. It was a tugboat 50 years old. So we went on the Black Sea, through the Black Sea, Dardanelles, and the Turks didn't want us to stop. Go, 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 go. Yala, yala, I think it was. And so we, the captain, went, we went to Piraeus, this harbor in the Mediterranean Sea, Greek. We had no food, no oil, no nothing. So we waited there a few days until the Greek Jewish community came to help and gave us food, shipped in, that's a service. 513 people. And then we started. And when we went, a day or two, on the free waters of the Aegean, two Italian little boats, marine, stopped us. Where are you going? You passed the mines, which were laid. It was 14 days before Greek and Turkey went to war. The mines you passed and you didn't explode because your weight is not so much. It was a small ship. If it had been by 20 inches deeper in the water, it would have flown in the air. So they gave us a direction and brought us over over the minefields, and we went to a direction. About midnight, an explosion. The engines were, we didn't have had enough drinking water, they mixed it with salt water, and the engines exploded. That was it. So the captain ordered all the sheets which we had, some women have with them in. They put it together, they put it together and hang it on the mast, and the wind was taking us to an uninhabited island by the name of Kamilanisi. But from the wrong side, because there were barriers. There were no high stone walls. The ship was anchored near to it, and it has taken the current, has taken us, fortunately, on a plateau. And so we stand there. But with the rise of the sea, we went up, and then when the waves came down, the ship broke. The ship resisted a lot, 2 days, it was Yom Kippur, and we started to evacuate. I have some pictures. We started to evacuate the ship and helped the women and children. You asked me before how many, 300 young men, and there were about 100 older people, older I mean 40 and over, and some married couples with some children. One never about 10 children, ages 6, 12.
Did anyone die? Did anyone die at that time?
At that time, nobody died. Only in the concentration camp, not too many, 7, I think, in the first concentration camp, dysentery.
So how did everybody get to the island?
Yeah. Now we saved the kitchen, and the food, what we had left, so many men and on the ship and in danger that the ship can sink any time. And we went, we established a kitchen on the island, on the stones. And everybody has taken only one to cover up on plate. And then, of course, we, in spite of the danger, young people went up and brought all the most of the packages. People had and brought it out so that everybody got, the ship was cleaned up in 10 hours during the day, even at night. And the second day when it was, we even took some wood, which was wooden deck, broke it on, brought it out to have for the kitchen too. To be able to cook. And so the 2 days the Pencho resisted. It was a noise to hear. 50 yards, 200 yards. Everybody found a niche somewhere to lay down. And so it broke down in two and fell back to the, in the sea. That was the end of the ship. And we have a Rosh Hashanah. Yom Kippur, I said. Yeah, it was Yom Kippur, and then it was Sukkot. And we have had the Torah. And most of us were davening. We didn't have had water. Drinking water. So we went, a few of us, 10, 15 young people, went to look for some water. There were holes deep, so we threw stones and there was water. But we didn't know if it was not salty water. It was a little bit salty, but drinkable. So we brought it out. Is that we saved some and made a chain from one to another. It was deep, maybe 20 yards deep. So we found a fountain of...
Were you frightened at that time?
Not really, because if you are in such a situation, you don't realize these things. You're not fine. Oh, they were women and were frightened of the children and all. But we young people, I talked to both myself, what else can happen?
Were there any leaders that emerged, anybody else who took charge and helped people and really organized activities?
Or no, we had the Betar organization.
But I mean the few members who were aboard. Were there people who emerged as leaders?
They were leaders from the beginning, so they have had influence on the organizational duty. And they were disciplined. There were no, except the German Jews, they always complained and they were never satisfied and they came late and made our lives miserable. But otherwise it was nice. Yeah, the German Jews, they were not German Jews, they were converted, they were from Poland. Most of them spoke Yiddish, but they were many born in Germany, so they have had higher standards of living, and they were not satisfied with this primitive, they expected, I don't know if they paid some money or not, but even if they paid, that was a risk to take.
So you are on this deserted island for how long?
I think about the 8th or 9th day. Oh, we, again the sheets, we asked everybody to pack out the sheets. The women took them together and make 20 times 20 SOS with shoe pasta, with shoe polish. SOS. And we waited SOS too when we brought the stones. They gathered the stones and made from the stones SOS too. So on the 8th day, or 9th, we see an airplane coming around, disappearing. We waved, but in an hour, hour or two came another one and went twice or three times around and nearer. Because we have had no radio, we had nothing. Not even pistols, right, in the night. Then they came again. And in the next day, came, we have seen far away a ship. We didn't know what kind of ship that is. Military. Italian. They came to us, about 3-4 officers. And there were about 3-4 people who spoke perfectly Italian. One of our men was an ex-Italian pilot. So they came over and to find out what's, and they asked us if we want to be saved under Mussolini. Sure. So they took with the boat, here and there, it has taken till the morning hours. And there was just, I think it was, the beginning or started a war between Britain and and Greece.
Mr. Rajsky, I'm going to stop you now so we can change the tape. The Italian army came, the Italian navy came, and
took about, from this 500, took about 250 women, married couples, and children. And they promised to be back to pick us up. The rest. And they came next day on a cruiser, military, could have been torpedoed by the British any time, because the British had just were under the, as we later found out, they had submarine there. So they took us in military organized camp. This military tent for four people, and we were supposed to be six in it.
Where was that?
On Rhodos, Rhodes Island. Very good air there, much better than here. And it has taken them 2 days until they built a kitchen. And in the meantime, we have had reserves, if we had one. I had some sardines. And so they started to cook, but they said, we will not pay for it. And so far, there here is a Jewish community of 5,000 people on Rhodos. And they organized and brought him in, and they came good, looking fine, normal, like nothing happened. Bankers and businessmen, this gold chain around, and looking at us like we were the animals. And they now try to be nice and made up some money for some soups. And the soups caused us, or were infected, I don't know. They built, the military built fast the place to, for big containers to cook. And so many of us got sick, many, most of us. The sickness, and the older people, about, I think about seven people died. We have had five doctors with us on our ship. One dentist and four doctors, medical doctors. And we had some medications which were saved from the ship. Some big anyway.
What did they die from?
Dysentery and complications. They were buried on the Jewish cemetery, as I remember. And then came joint. And then it has taken a week or two until joint came, or more, 4 weeks. And then we got some piece of bread. And some peas and some macaroni and things like that. And it was cooked in the kitchen, which we took over military the way. And we had about 10 people who were assigned by us to be the organizers and to have the responsibility. One of them, Perlman, has had the right to go in town to buy some food. I have had a gold watch. My father bought me before we were shipped. So I gave him the watch and he brought me some food, oil, macaroni and rice. And there were stones there from a building. It was a building. We were first floor divided in big spaces. No windows, only big doors. And above us were Italian Marines placed on vacation. But they had the other side. And we were surrounded by guards and they had fun, these guys. They threw cigarettes and our people, how I was ashamed, fought about a few cigarettes, grabbing on the air, fighting about a cigarette. At that time I was no smoker, so it was easier for me to criticize, but I didn't like it.
Did they tell you how long you'd be on that island, on Rhodes?
No. There was no plan or anything, but one day I was there a year and a half. In the first year I came with the idea that we should, in the neighborhood, was a garden, was a field, and if they would give us the possibility, we could have vegetables for our, And so we did. We did 20, 30 men, and they brought us showers, and we, but that was our initiative. And we digged and planted. But it was a good time to kill, a good time to work, and
who supervised you on the island?
The military.
From what country?
Italians. Well, they were in the charge of everything. Every 50 yards was not military, but a fascist organization. But they were primitive, simple people. They left us. We have had a few who started to do business with them. And they let in some food, fruit. And so. But after a few weeks, we got a shop where they brought in and we could buy some oranges, some figs. But they were second class, third class quality, but they were good. And who has money? No, I had the money from the gold, and then I had a cigarette. It's golden. So that I sold too, and so I had. And many of us did the same. Many, maybe 20, maybe 50, but not all. Many were hungry, terrible. And I digged out with my knives oven from the half concrete block. And there were orange trees, neglected and dry pieces where we could use to make fire and cook something. We have it. I had a cooker, military. So I cooked the rice. No, nothing else. Rice. Until it was okay, so I ate it. That was my supplement to the soups.
Did everybody take care of their own food?
No, we had our kitchen. But the kitchen was very poor supplied. Only not able to survive, but we survived. Some miracle. Because many of us didn't have had nothing left.
Did you hear what was happening in the war in Europe? Did you get news? How did you get that news?
A few of us who spoke Italian got it from the guards. Some illegal Italian newspaper came in, and so we knew what's going on. I studied with my two friends who don't live anymore. Both of them died in Italy. One in the camp and one in the bombardment of Bari in Italy by the Allied forces. He was an interpreter there. 44, 45. So the food was miserable, of course, and my ulcers came up. So I have a diet. So according to the doctors which we had, it was a blessing for me. And I have had only diet food. And,
what were the sanitary conditions like?
Sanitary, we have had to take care of it, and we were okay. We had in the backyard, we had our places where to go. Of course, it was primitive, it was only to sit down. But
did you have a schedule every day? A regular schedule?
Well, at 8 o'clock we have had to stand at our places. There we have had just beds. And we had to appello. But they went through and they...
What happened with Jewish holidays? Did you know when they came?
Oh, yes, yes. We had Sefer Torah with us, and so we knew. And some talis and tefillin. But I didn't make tefillin. I don't know. I took with me, but somehow it got lost.
What special things did you take with you when you left Czechoslovakia?
What special things? A few shirts, trousers, warm clothing, and one pack of sardines and some food preserves. I had had a bag and a coffer, and it was quite heavy when I left.
After a year and a half that you spent on roads, where did you go from there?
We were transferred to the concentration camp of Ferramonti. Tarsia was the village. It was Ferramonti Tarsia. There were barracks for 40 people, 40 beds full of roaches. And what's their name? They ate our blood. But we, every week, every 10 days, we burned them out. But then I started to... I went to the authority, and with the help of the Jewish representative, there were about 1,800 in the camp. There were Yugoslav partisans and Chinese living in Italy, internment. But most of us were 1,200 Jews. We have had a football team, a soccer team, and the Greeks had a soccer team. And we have had the first and the second soccer team. So we played on a place.
How had you been taken to that camp?
Yeah, I forgot that. By ship. We went about a week it has taken until, because there was war between Italy and German occupied Turkey, Greece, And we have it all the time on us, this saving, you know, not to drown. And it's taken from one place to another. The ship where we laid on the floor, under the ship, over the ship. But it was a human, half human, comparison to the German. So the Italians are different. Even if they were fascists, they looked upon us as human beings. They were forced.
How did they tell you they were going to move you? Why did they move you?
I never find out. It was started because I think, we think that the Germans wanted us. Because the Germans were not far away in Greece. And this was Italy. So they wanted us as enemies not to be close to the Turkish coast.
When did you arrive at that camp in Tarsi? What year?
1942. 42, February, March, 42. I remember I came, I see a few people together between the barracks. And I go there and listen to two young men who escaped from working on a railroad under the supervision of SS from Auschwitz. And they told us that they are burning people and gassing people. We could not believe it. And they came, they jumped on the train coming from the Russian front with Italian soldiers, and the Italian soldiers kept them hidden until they came to Italian soil, and then they gave them over to the secret police, and they brought them to our camp, and they told us these stories. We could not believe it. They were right. And that was the beginning. So, then we have had this visit of the Pabst, the Pope. Now he used the name, German name, Pabst. The Pope, Pope's delegate, some half cardinal, came to visit us, how we are doing, and so somewhere I had the photographs, but I could not, I don't know if I have them over. Anyway, so we were there. And the food was a little bit better, but no luxury. There was a store where we could buy if we had money. But I came with the idea, and I with my two friends, to build a garden, to dig in the soil. There was most sand. But we brought soil and we got the permission and we had a very nice garden. It was the, that was 43. And then it's warm, so we started in February or even end of January, and some different types of vegetables. And I applied through my friend, who was the head of our, at the time. He had a friend, an Austrian Jew, in a camp near Salerno in Italy, in the mountains. Campania is the name of the village, and Campania is the name of the district. And he has a friend who has a heart condition, I remember myself, who has, I heard the first time, angina pectoris. And that he would need his cousin. I was supposed to be the cousin. I got the permission after three or four months, came the permission. You have to go tomorrow. I left my garden. My friends sent me some money, and because they sold a lot and used it. And I think it was 700 lira.
How did you get there?
By train, with accompanied by a carabinieri. No, a secret service man. But it was not an SS. And when we came in the train, everything was sitting, no place. He said, at the window, come on, go on. And he took my hand back and put it above us, and we have had two places. Yeah. Then we arrived at the station, and there was a bus, and with the bus we came to the, in the mountains there was, as I told you before, was the convent, a church. The convent was not occupied, so we were occupied by about 145. Mostly older people, a few young people, I mean young, 30. And it was my age. And there we have had beds, first time, not crowded together, but a little bit place, and good air.
What was the name of this?
Campania.
We're going to stop the camera so we can change the tape.
And I have to go somewhere.
Mr. Rajsky, you were talking about the camp in Campania.
Yeah, I was brought in, and I think it was May 45. And there we have had some easier. Once in a week we went to the movies.
This is May of what year?
45. 43. I'm rushing. Once a week in the movies. But otherwise supervised by carabinieri's only, so police, and supervised by the secret police. 15 people, as I know. When I came, arrived with the so-called Happe, as we told him, we named him a secret service agent, who brought me over, and at the bus station was the head of the secret police force of this little village. 15 people watching 145. 80 were older, over 50. Well, anyway, so he introduced me, introduced myself, shake hands like human beings. In a concentration camp, shake hands. And he told me he wants to see me in his office tomorrow morning. So I came and he explained the these and regulations, and we departed as good friends. That's all. Now, I lived there, and we, young people, about six, seven of us, had the permission to go to a nearby little stream, clear water, and we enjoyed the sun, and that was a little bit, in comparison to the previous camps, it was a little bit recreation.
Were there only men in this camp?
Only men. And this was what else can I say?
Did they give you a job at the camp?
No.
So how did...
It was recreation. We were not that I would... That's the truth. I suffered enough, but many people suffered more. As I described you, about the 11th of September, the Allies came, or a week before, they started in Salerno, bombardments we heard, and they proceeded, and the Germans retreated from the area. And so about the 11th of September 45. They came to the camp, American soldiers, and congratulated us.
Did the Germans come for you at all?
The Germans were looking for us when we were in the woods.
How long were you in the woods?
11 or 12 days. But They didn't catch one of us because we had the help of the Italian peasant. But once they surprised us, and we went, there was high grass growing near to the little stream. It was over the knee high. And when we have seen them behind the corner, we lay down, three of my friends, and they didn't see us. If they would have saw, if they would have seen us, they would have taken us.
This was the Germans?
Yeah. Yeah, the Germans.
And then?
Three young men. One was shot and killed from the Italian police, which was hiding with us, as I heard. I was not a witness to that.
And did you go back to the camp? Where did you go?
We went back to the camp, of course. We have our belongings. And after maybe a week or two, we were asked by the Palestinian unit, which was a part of the British Army, 8th Army, if we want to work in the kitchens of the army. And the Palestinian unit, which were Jewish, they came over, put this line, how many, we were about 12, and the Captain Lachman, German Jew, came to me, sprechen Sie Deutsch? How? Because most of us spoke German. Now he wanted me to the officers' mess, washing dishes and big pants. And they have two cooks for 11 officers and their assistants, soldiers. So 24 people. And it was in a building occupied by the British Army from the fascist organization. And so when the cook got sick, I went to the hospital, the surgeon came and asked me if I can cook. I said, yes, I can. I had experience in the camp where I cooked for myself. And then I was always at home too, looking at my mother's work. So I got promoted to the cook. I was cooking for them about 9.5 months.
Did you wear a uniform, or?
I had the right to wear a uniform. They gave me a uniform, and I could have been private. When I went to the theater, which was open, sometimes I went in civil suit, sometimes I went quite often, two, three times a week, Verdi, and the Italian opera.
Why did you decide to stay there at that time?
There was nowhere to go. It was only 10 miles, then 20 or 30, 40 miles was the front. And these were units who supplied supply to the front, to the battle front, to the battling units. And now after I have to think, forgetting the names. Anyway, there was a big battle between the Germans retreating and the advancement of the 5th American Army and the 8th British. And I don't know the village, I forgot. It's a monastery, everything was destroyed. I have seen then the damage when I passed by car. So then was the Americans disembarked, occupying Anzio, which is in the history of the American army, not the best performance. But anyway, they were holding there, and the Germans retreated, and Rome was not bombarded. After they retreated from Rome, I decided to go to Rome. Now with military vehicles, with permission, and I went to the ex-Czechoslovakian embassy, which was occupied by the SS, and There were three people sent from London, from the Czechoslovakian government, in exile to take over. So we cleaned up the mess, mainly in the basement where there was blood on everywhere because they tortured. The SS tortured Italians, Jews, So we cleaned that up, and I got a room, a big, nice room in the embassy. And was named to cooperate between the refugees which came, Czech and Slovak refugees which came from the north, deserting the Czech and Slovak units who fought under Hitler. So I interviewed them and reported to the people responsible for the safety. So this I did for a few months. I had a private room and a private house and a private family too. So, and that was still November 45. In November, November 45, I registered to go back. Stupid me.
To go back where?
To Czechoslovakia. But with the information that only 2 years I should take care of my family because I knew from the embassy's information bureau that my uncle and his family are alive, and my brother is alive, but my parents, sister, were not in there. So I decided to go, younger brother, and to take care of our business. But it turned out it's a half communist and half anti-Semites, that it was very difficult to get back your own house, which we didn't get back until today. And the fields, on this we got back and we started to work as my brother and myself, as farmers. And it was very difficult. It was only a temporary arrangement. My uncle got back his house and his property.
What was his name?
Emmanuel.
And was he your maternal or paternal?
Brother. My father's brother. And he was holding on, and then he took over. We gave him our part. And my brother started the information and newspaper writing because of me, because I suggested that he should write, but not communists, but the labor organization newspaper.
Is that a local newspaper?
No, that was in Bratislava, Prešov. That was for the whole Slovakia. And so I trained him, because I was a newspaper man before, I didn't mention this. I love to write, write stories, write reports, and it was in the spa of Pieszczany, near to about 6-7 miles from my town, Vrbove. And so I suggested temporarily that he should do that. I wanted to sell what we could, something we sold, but it was too fast. I knew. I was informed by the ambassador in Rome that it will take two, three years maximum until the Russian will occupy Czechoslovakia. I should hurry. In the meantime, my wife, we met.
How did you meet her?
Friends in this town. There were 80 Jews, but not from the 800. Some from other places. And they were supported by Hayes. So they lived temporarily there. And I came from Prague and pendled here and there and met my wife and came to a love affair. And but I was involved in the because they're from Poland, they came, some Jewish people, from the concentration camps. And we, when they came to our region, we, Betarim, advised them to Prague and bought them some tickets or so. And then I transferred because there was nothing to do for me there. So I transferred completely to Prague. And there was an office of the Betar and the new Zionist organization, Jabotinsky. And I worked in the office and in the help of hundreds and hundreds of people to go through the border to West Germany. And that was still 47, 48.
When did you get married?
48. February 23rd.
And you lived in Prague?
Yeah. Then I lived there. And started to... In 46, I started to write in leading Italian sports daily. Oh, I forgot the name. Exists even now. Anyway. And I was correspondent from Czech and Slovak newspaper, even a Hungarian. I didn't write Hungarian. I wrote them in Slovak and they translated. So this was my official work at the time. But it didn't bring enough money. So I... And that was not... And when the communists have taken over, it was not... I was out, because I was not a communist, I could not have...
When was that?
48. 48, 49. And I went to do some selling of books, as I mentioned to you. Reading. So, and I was quite successful for a few months, but we applied for Israel. We just had to go in a week or 5 days or our transport was scheduled and paid for. My wife got some complications with her inside and was hospitalized for 8 days, 9 days. At the time when the transport, the last transport, 39, left Prague. So we have to start again from scratch, a new application.
What was the year it left? What year?
That was 49.
Okay.
And the communists were in more and more aggressive. I stopped before writing anything. I didn't write against communists because I had the feeling that sports are politics. Well, anyway, and we had a nice apartment in mid-city of Prague. And they brought me in, as I mentioned, the so-called personnel referent, but they were the terrorists who, communist terrorists who terrorized people who didn't agree with them in a factory, in a big factory, and he was the head of this. He was the unit. And they forced me without asking me or something and put him in with his wife and son.
And they moved you into their, them into your apartment?
Yes. But I could not mind if I would have mind because I hoped I would get the permission for going out. But the permission didn't come, and probably I neglected it because I didn't pay enough to bribe. Well, I was afraid at the time to bribe too, because I didn't know whom to bribe. So we got stuck. And we didn't. We were not employed. I was registered as a farmer and journalist. But that was according to the communist doctrine, I was not employed. So they wanted to get the whole of my two rooms. And one morning at 5 o'clock they came and picked us up, my wife and myself. Only what we have clothing we should put on, and took us to the police station. When they interrogated us and terroristic methods and let us the whole day, and they transported, we were there about 3 weeks, cramped in a room. 35 people where 5 people would have lived.
Who were the other people in with you?
Oh, there was a major from the British. A Czech who was with the British opened his mouth and he was in. And people like this who didn't agree with the communists.
How long did you stay there?
3 weeks.
And then what happened?
They tortured us too. Then one day they came and picked me up without telling me about my wife. And transported me to a labor camp. In the meantime, my arches started to bother me. I worked 3 days and then I fell down somehow and they let me lay down. No doctor. No doctor, no medication, nothing. And I had, just a week before they picked me up, I had a working agreement with a smaller company to be a salesperson, and I had to start in a week. And they missed it, I missed it, it was disregarded, because they wanted to take away my nice apartment.
Mr. Rajsky, I'm going to stop the camera so we can change the tape. You were talking about having been in prison. Did you know at any time where your wife was?
No. Any time later, when she was in the camp, in the women's camp far away, I found out, I don't know what way, and she wrote me and I wrote her back and we have corresponded.
Did you have to be hospitalized for your ulcers?
After. At that time. Today, ulcers are not a problem.
You were talking about how you missed the sales clerk's job.
Yeah. So, that the intervention of the, who was a communist, but I would say an exemption, a nice guy, with my Jewish friend, came to the camp, but I was just gone. But they, some intervention, and my wife, because she was a good worker, she got the permission to go to Prague to visit her friends or anything, and visited our communist supervisor in the office of the communist Ministry of Interior. And I don't know, he liked her or so, and with some help. First she went to a so-called commission, comprised with communist exponents. And they gave her a year for education in a concentration camp. I was good for 2 years, without any interrogation. They asked me a few questions, why I don't work? I say, I work. How? This and this and this. Doesn't count. I say, I have to start as a salesperson. Doesn't count. That was just in 5 minutes, and it was sealed 2 years. But somehow we got information. Now she visited me. She got the permission to visit me. I worked in a restaurant then.
Where was that?
Pardubice. That was the second place where they transported me to. And if I want to work, I worked. I washed dishes and big pans. And had a practice. And a practice from the military. And I have had to schlep, you know what schlep is? Coal from the underground in the second floor kitchen. It was maybe 30, 40 steps. 4 or 5 times a day. That was, for my ulcer, that was a recreation. And anyway, so I survived that too. But because I was a good worker, and because she was a good worker in a factory at the time, so she got the permission to come to Prague, and the owner, who was not anymore the owner, but was a communist registered, so he could keep as a manager and be as a manager, he promised her to be overnight. Oh, about 3 times, 4 times we met in the span of 4 or 5 months. And so we were in communication. Then she was transferred. But anyway, she will tell you. From this camp, one day a doctor, so-called doctor, was there. And we were in a, and I had worked out hands from this coal and washing the dishes and soap. So he looked at my hands, can go to the mining of uranium in another camp. So there I went twice or so in the shift down. Somehow I think I pretended to break down. But I have the history of my ulcer. So they offered me if I can work in the office. So I registered a writing in the office of the FBI. Imagine that. Twisted life. So after 6 months, they released us. But we didn't have where to live, so we went to a hotel. I had some money left. I asked my uncle to send me money, and I had it in the bank. We sold some property before. So we went to the hotel. Then we went to the ministry, to the big boss. And I say, you are giving me now in the outskirts, in a family little house, upstairs, where there is no facility, nothing except water running, and no to use together with the other family in the bathroom, in the floor, first floor. He said to me, if you don't like it, I can send you back. So I liked it. It was about 7 years until I worked out.
Did you remain there the whole 7 years?
Pardon?
Did you live there the whole 7 years?
In these 2 rooms with 2 children, 7 years it was, from 50, December 50, till about 7 years.
Tell me the names of your children.
Sonia and Daniela.
When were they born?
Sonia was, is her daughter. Sonia was born in Piešťany, Slovakia, 1945, November 26. But I regarded her as mine, and until she was 15, good friends in Budapest told her, not the grandparents, that I'm not her father. And since then she was different. Why? No reason. left her like my own. No, and then was 52 was Daniela born.
And after you, after the 7 years, where did you go?
Oh, I managed. I was. First, I worked on a building construction, hard work, manual work. So I broke down, pain. So hospital and specialist, and I managed to have a good specialist. Then I was again in the hospital for 6 weeks. Then I was in a spa for 4 weeks or five, recommended by a specialist. And then I applied in a department store again to clean up a mess the second time in my life. There were manco, which means bad, no evidences of parts, of auto parts and cleaning for the 5-6 story building and for 800 employees. So there were papers, paper to, for items, there were no so specialized sacks, handy, and plastic, everything was paper. So this and everything for the offices, there were 6, 7, 8 offices. And so about maybe 600, 800 items to, well, no computers, only cards. And so I brought it together. I got some help to for this heavy work of transporting this packing papers. There were tons. And so I brought it in order, and I was there 5 years.
When did you come to the United States?
1966.
And when you came here, where did you go to live?
My wife had an aunt and the aunt has a son, and the aunt lived in Allentown, Pennsylvania. We gave it to the IS as an address, and they transported us to. But I had some little money, and we had highest paid about 80 liras a day, which were at the time, I don't know, $4 or something. Anyway, we got in a private room to live in Rome.
What kind, that was before you came here?
Yes.
But when you came to this country, what kind of work did you do?
First, I got a laborer's work in a Jewish factory. After 3 months, I asked my boss, to make it short, if he has not in this big factory a different job, it's not a job for me to pick up the needles of a machine which sewing machine. He came back, the son. No, they don't have anything. So I called up, wrote on three to Chicago, as I remember, to New York, to Port Amboy, New Jersey, that I am a refugee and I am a newspaperman if they can use me. So I got a call from New Jersey, Port Amboy, little newspaper in Czech and Slovak language. I should come to. That was 80 miles, but with my old car. We both had cars. So I was accepted, and I was there for a year, but it has, they gave me $90 a week, and then 100, and 110. I said, 120. Okay, but it has no future. So at night I studied the insurance language, the insurance codes, everything connected with life and hospitalization insurance and health insurance. At nights from 9 till midnight at least. And then I went to work, 8 o'clock. I was there. This lasted a whole year. My wife was waitressing with her language, not knowing a word. She started in a kitchen, in a Hungarian kitchen. And I went every Monday away. She cooked me everything. I lived in upstairs in a hot place in the summertime. Oh boy, no air conditioning. And learning, if you are sweating and it's hot, it's double difficult. So this was. I liked the work, what I did. I wrote about the communist terror and my experiences and so far. It was easy for me to write it in Slovak. And it was published and was read. But he said, the owner and the manager, I could transfer my family here. She can be a waitress here too. And it's a multi-language, more people just being Slovak and Czech and Hungarian. It was near to New York. And 5 rooms in the first floor over there in the other house. I said, I stay in quiet Allentown. I don't know. I don't want New York.
And then what did you do?
Went through a mill of insurance business. I passed the examination with the help of a manager who was very nice. I passed the examination in life and in health insurance with New York Life, which everybody knows, New York Life, but I could not do. I could not do the volume what they required. So I agreed to quit and to go to a company which collected monthly. Some of them were weeklies. But anyway, I changed it in a year. It was an easier, much easier work. And my salary came from 150 to 200, 250. And after 5 years, I was 60 years old. I said to my manager, after consulting my wife and convincing her that she can get first we went for exploration. I don't know if it is important. Exploration, if we can have a job in Florida.
When did you move to Florida?
When did I move to Florida? '73, I think.
And did you work when you came down here?
Yeah. First of all, we went on vacation for 2 weeks in a not air-conditioned Chrysler. And then I went with my daughter the same way and found that Rockefeller has built his mansion in Ormond Beach after employing 7 experts to find out the best place in the United States. I said, if Rockefeller is for Rockefeller, it's good, so it's good for me. So we settled in that area. And we went. I told my manager, 2 weeks. He says, are you crazy? How old are you? 60. You will be with us another 5 years, and you will have a pension. And I don't want the winter to shoulder, the snow and the cold and the slick roads and ugly. I have enough. I go. And we went.
Mr. Rajsky, after the war and after your stay in Czechoslovakia, when you came to this country, did you talk to people about the fact that you were a Holocaust survivor? Did you talk about your experiences at all?
A few friends knew, of course.
What about?
Only a few Jews.
What about to your daughter? Did you talk about your Holocaust experiences with your daughter?
Which one?
Daniela.
Daniela, of course. Sure. She knows. She knows.
Did you give your daughter Jewish education?
No. I was maybe chicken. I got from the Jewish community, before my stomach operation, I went to the rabbi of Prague and told him that I would like to have a Jewish burial if I cannot survive. What burial? You're going only for an operation. I'm 43 years old. I have 2 children. Don't worry. Nothing will happen. The rabbi told you nothing will happen, so nothing will happen. Anyway, so that's only part of the story. I survived, and since then I can eat nails. Now, who did you ask? What I have not answered. If I told Daniel, if I told other people, under the communist rule, it was not advisable to make too much noise. And I got from the Jewish community, I got the papers, monthly papers, and I asked them to stop it in, I don't know, a few years before we came to the United States. I asked them to stop it. I didn't want to play. Everybody knew in the house that I am Jewish. But we kept quiet.
How do you think the experiences of being a Holocaust survivor and also surviving the communist regime, how did that affect your life?
First of all, I have asked a question. Is there a God? After my parents, after perished my family for 27 people, uncles, cousins. Is there a God? I know about the Spanish Inquisition, but they had at least the possibility to choose. Go away, take what you have, and go. That was many years before the Inquisition. They didn't believe it. But we were not even told. But we were told by example, but we didn't want to listen, and we didn't ignore it. So, what was the question?
How did your experiences affect your life? And you answered it. Your question.
I answered my life. Now the new explorations, even 20, 30 years ago, are breathtaking and affected thinking about our Torah, which was written 600 years after the fact from different rabbis. It's not taught a real story to us children who were 14, 15 and ask questions. I don't know how we can. I was a nationalist, a Jewish nationalist, but the davening, so the same I have in my mind, if I have the opportunity, I pray Kaddish. I don't need a book. I have it in my head.
Do you often think about your parents?
Yeah, sure.
When was the last time you saw them?
That was when I left for the ship.
Do you remember what your mother said to you or your father?
My father went with me and my uncle to Bratislava, where we were overnight, and then he bought me these golden things and some money, but my mother, when I was leaving, embraced me. And said, I'll never see you again. I said, oh, Mama, don't. You will see me. Two years after. Was that? Well, can I forget? Can I excuse it somehow? Can I? No. In the last breath, I despise a nation which can be, but most of the nations can be biased and brought to craziness. but in intelligence, high-level living and high-level thinking, having thinkers like Goethe, Schiller, and so far, I could not believe it because I was a Germanophile, my perfect German education. I have as a private teacher for years. I'm even now perfect in writing. Talking is more difficult. I have to look for the expressions and words because I don't practice the language. But if something like that can happen, everything can happen. Even in America.
Mr. Rajsky, we're going to stop the camera so we can change the tape.
I have seen.
Rajsky, this is tape 7. Mr. Rajsky, is there anything else you'd like to add to your testimony?
I don't know, to tell you the truth. I don't know what I missed, but maybe something, but it has not too much influence on the whole story.
Why did you want to give your testimony?
That's a good question. Well, for future generations. Because if now we have the survivalist and all this junk individuals who are losers are organizing and organized by mostly, I think, German provenience people who incite them, organize them, and they are telling the American people and the people around the world, if they would have the possibility. They do it in Denmark, they do it in Sweden, as I read in the papers, that Holocaust was not happening. And I testified to that. I was not killed. Many tried. I was not gassed. And I survived. And I would like to let all the people who would look, who would be interested to look at the tapes, know that I am one of the living witnesses and proof of these terrible things which happened.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Rajsky, please introduce your wife.
That's my wife, Susan. Yeah, recently, 50 years married recently, we had an anniversary and a party, but no alcohol. And
you take care of one another?
We take care of one another. She has had problems with her back for years and years, and pain. Until
we're taking care of each other.
Yes. Can you tell us something about your husband?
About my husband?
Yes.
Yes, he was always a good provider and a hard worker. Good father, and always had a special dream, but we actually did it, to come to United States. So that's what I can tell about him right now.
Thank you. Who is in this picture?
My father.
What is his name?
Joseph Reisman.
When was this taken?
1938, probably.
Where was it taken?
In Vrbove, our town.
And did he survive the Holocaust?
No.
Okay, thank you. Who is in this picture?
My mother.
What is her name?
Sidonia.
Where was this taken?
In my hometown, Brbove, 1938.
Did she survive the war?
No.
Okay, thank you. Is in this picture?
Me and my sister.
What is her name?
Serene.
Do you know when this was taken?
Well, approximately 1920.
Do you know, where was it taken?
In Vrbove, her hometown.
Did she survive?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Auschwitz.
Who is in this picture?
Me.
When was this taken? Where was it
20,
taken?
1920.
Where was it taken?
In Vrbove.
Czechoslovakia?
Czechoslovakia.
Thank you.
It shouldn't be on there.
Who is in this picture?
My cousin.
What is his name?
Oscar.
Is that from left to right?
Reisman, from left to right.
Who is next?
Me, myself.
Next?
His closest friend of mine. Kraus.
Who is next?
Another friend by the name of Sinai.
And who is on the end?
Another friend, We were the same age. Well, Rosenman.
When was this taken? Before the war?
Yes.
And where was it taken?
This was taken in Vrbove.
Czechoslovakia.
Czechoslovakia.
Did they all survive?
Only me and the fifth on the right, Rostman.
Do you know where the others died?
Auschwitz.
Okay, thank you. Describe this picture, please.
That was taken in as we see the rabbis and the supervisor, it was an Orthodox girls' vacation place.
Where was this taken?
In Slovakia, in the mountains of maybe 100 miles from our
town. And when was it taken?
She was 15. She was born in 18.
1933?
1933.
Did she survive?
No, Auschwitz.
Okay, thank you. Describe this picture.
That's a soccer team from the town of Vrbove, my hometown. And
when was it taken?
Man, I don't remember precisely, about 36 maybe.
And where are you in this picture?
Kneeling on the right hand side or the left from the
right. You're on the right hand side looking at the picture.
On the left hand side of the black sweater.
The right hand side looking at the picture.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Describe this picture.
This is the kitchen which we saved from the capsized Pencho on the island of Kamilanissi. And there...
Where was it taken?
After we capsized, a day or two after.
1940? Okay, thank you. Who is in this picture?
My wife, my daughter Daniela, and myself.
What is your wife's name?
Susan.
Okay. When was it taken?
When was it taken?
1997?
Maybe 96.
Where was it taken?
In Kissimmee.
Okay, Florida.
Florida.
Okay, thank you.
Very, our 50th wedding anniversary. My gosh.
What?
Who is in this picture?
My granddaughter.
What is her name?
Jessica.
Jessica what?
Feuerstein.
How old is she?
6 years old.
Where was this taken? In the United
Recently.
States?
Recently in the United States.
Okay, thank you.